Here's a look at today's top four at four. Authorities say a standoff in Moorhead that shut down part of the city all started with a stolen car chase. Minnesota State Patrol says they tried to pull over a speeding vehicle in the southern part of the city just after midnight, but it took off. The car eventually spun out on 34th Street South, and the two people inside ran to a nearby apartment building. Authorities tried to get them to come outside, but they wouldn't. Officers eventually went into the building and arrested the two suspects, as well as the person whose apartment they were hiding in. Fargo police are still asking for your help finding a suspect in a recent shooting at the Arbors apartment complex. 21-year-old Oliver Ty has been charged with attempted murder along with other crimes in connection to the January 24th shooting. If you have any information on Ty's whereabouts, call police immediately. He is considered armed and dangerous, so officers are urging you not to approach him. NDSU has released new game day procedures for the upcoming spring football season. The biggest upset for some, no tailgating. They're limiting seating to 50% capacity and accommodating season ticket holders, students, and player pass list up to 9,500 people for the first home game on Sunday, February 21st. For more information, just head to our website, valleynewslive.com, and click on this story. Dustin Diamond, best known for his portrayal of the lovable nerd Screech on Saved by the Bell, has died. A spokesperson confirms the actor died this morning, weeks after he was diagnosed with cancer. His manager says Diamond was taken off of breathing machines in an attempt to move him to hospice care, but passed away with loved ones nearby. He was 44. That wraps up today's top four at four. Now here's a first look at our weather with Chief Meteorologist Hutch Johnson. Hutch.
Stacy, hello. I hope everybody had a great weekend. We are still battling some gray skies, soupy conditions, and some fog. A fog advisory continues for our western counties in the James River Valley, Jamestown, and Point South. Here's a look at those visibilities. The fog actually extends north into the Devil's Lake Basin. Langdon reporting a mile or so of visibility at this hour. It's improved as you go across the river into Minnesota, where temperatures are in the teens for some in Bedette and Bemidji, but holding on to 20s elsewhere heading into our evening. The radar fairly quiet this evening, although I cannot rule out a renegade flake of snow here or there as we take a look at your planning forecast tonight. Steady temperatures with winds from the south keeping us mild, and those clouds will keep us from getting too cold tonight. Up in Grand Forks, much the same, as you can see from our shot there on the dike. A lot of cloud cover, low 20s there. We have big changes to talk about. A midweek storm, we'll update you on that. First Alert Weather Day is now hoisted for the weekend ahead, and we'll talk about why here in just a few moments. But winter, it's not done yet, and February, as we get started, looks to be a little snowier and a little colder to start.
All right, we'll be ready. Thanks, Hutch. We'll take a look at this. A warning about checking the ice before you drive on it. A Chevy pickup drove through a crack on Big Pine Lake in Perham. Tri-State Diving says it was still on top of the ice with the front bumper holding it up. Last Saturday, the same crew saved a wheeled fish house that broke through due to warm temperatures. After President Joe Biden revoked Keystone XL's presidential permit, opponents of other pipelines are hoping the projects they've been fighting will be next. Environmentalists and American Indian tribes called on President Biden to stop Enbridge Energy's Line 3 replacement in Minnesota. Opponents of the Dakota Access Pipeline that originates in North Dakota also appealed to the administration. Industry experts say they don't expect any quick action like that order that stopped the Keystone XL, but other pipelines will likely see tougher scrutiny than they saw under former President Donald Trump. Minnesota could be a step closer to legalizing marijuana. Democratic leaders in the state have introduced a bill that would allow adults to use the drug. Lawmakers say the bill would create a responsible regulatory structure as well as expunging most marijuana convictions. Senate Majority Leader Ryan Winkler, who wrote the bill, says the criminalization of cannabis has failed, disproportionately affecting people of color. 15 states, including neighboring South Dakota, have voted to legalize recreational marijuana. Minnesotans age 65 and older will have greater access to the COVID vaccine. This comes after state health officials announced that the state is getting 35,000 additional doses. The announcement increases the number of older adults who can receive the vaccine while boosting the number of locations providing the shots. One of the big concerns voiced by seniors regarding Minnesota's vaccine rollout was only 9 community sites. Many had to travel long distances to get vaccinated. Fargo Cass Public Health is relocating its vaccine operation to the former Gordman's building. Sanford and Essentia Health are already vaccinating their patients there. This move helps keep everything centralized in the county and will hopefully help the vaccine rollout run smoothly once the vaccine becomes more available to the general public. 10 Republican senators will head to the White House today to discuss their scaled-down COVID economic rescue plan with President Biden. The efforts at bipartisanship come as Senate Democrats ramp up their threats to go it alone on the president's proposed $1.9 trillion stimulus package. Skylar Henry is at the White House with the latest.
This afternoon, a group of Republican senators is meeting with the president and vice president at the White House to discuss their $600 billion COVID relief counterproposal.
It's an exchange of ideas, an opportunity to do that. What this meeting is not is a forum for the president to make or accept an offer.
Senate Republicans have balked at the $1.9 trillion price tag of President Biden's proposal. Both plans call for $160 billion for COVID vaccine distribution, testing, and PPE supplies. Differences in the GOP proposal include smaller direct stimulus payments with a lower income cutoff and lower weekly unemployment insurance payments only lasting through June.
We're targeted to the needs of the American people, treating our tax dollars as if there are tax dollars, not just money to spend.
The president has consistently called for bipartisanship in COVID relief negotiations, but the Biden administration also cautions against passing a bill that's too small.
On MSNBC, West Virginia's Republican governor also called for a large package.
We need to go big, and if we waste some money now, well, we waste some money. But absolutely, we've got too many people hurting.
We hope that we can move forward in a bipartisan way with our Republican colleagues cooperating.
Congressional Democrats say they may act on the president's proposal without Republican support in a process called budget reconciliation, which would allow the plan to pass in the Senate with a simple majority. Skylar Henry, CBS News, the White House.
President Biden is calling for $350 billion in funding for state and local governments in his COVID economic rescue plan, while Senate Republicans have no state and local funding in their proposal. New data from the CDC is shedding more light on who has gotten the COVID vaccine so far. One study looked at vaccination rates in more than 11,000 skilled nursing facilities with at least one vaccination clinic between mid-December and mid-January. It showed nearly 78% of residents and 38% of staff members received at least one dose of the vaccine. A second study analyzed all vaccine recipients during the first month of availability. Researchers found of the approximately 13 million people who were vaccinated, 63% were women, 55% were over 50 years old. If you're looking to stay on top of the latest vaccine information, get our new VNL vaccine tracker. You can access national and local resources in just two easy steps. Just open your phone camera and point it at the QR code on your screen, then tap the link that pops up. Gray Television is in the process of purchasing Quincy Media at the price tag of $925 million. The company will own stations that serve 102 different TV markets. With the purchase, Gray Television would expand their reach in Minnesota, acquiring KBJR out of Duluth and KTTC in Rochester. The purchase of the company was approved unanimously by the board of directors of both Gray and Quincy. Well, snow is blanketing the country. We'll show you which areas are bracing for another foot.
Not that much snow, but we do have some flakes to talk about and some cold February conditions coming as well. Details in your hour-by-hour forecast are straight ahead.